Hi, this is Dr. Erdi Fadrigilan. I am a heartbeat specialist. Thank you very much for watching this. Hi, this is Dr. Erdi Fadrigilan. I am a heartbeat specialist. Welcome to my YouTube channel. Today is another ECG reading session, and please join me in reading and interpreting this ECG tracing. This is the ECG tracing of a patient who was referred to me because of a finding of a bradycardia or a slow heartbeat in his ECG tracing. So now let's examine his ECG. So this is the ECG tracing showing the limb leads, leads 1, lead 2, lead 3, AVR, AVL, and AVF. The precordial leads, V1, V2, V3, V4, V5, and V6. So now let's go back to the first page of this ECG and take the rate, the rhythm, the intervals, the duration, and the QRS axis. So first, measuring the atrial rate, which is measured from a P wave, its beginning, the beginning of another P wave, and they are separated by 45 small boxes. Dividing 1,500 by 45 is 33 beats per minute. The ventricular rate is similarly measured, and it is also separated by 45 small boxes. Again, that is 33 beats per minute for the ventricular rate. The PR interval in this ECG, which is measured from the beginning of the P wave to the beginning of the QRS, is 7 small boxes, and multiplying it by 0.04 is 0.28. So the PR interval is 0.28. The QRS duration measured from the beginning of the Q wave to the end of the QRS, 5 small boxes. So multiplying it again at 0.04, it's 0.20. Now the assessed QT is measured from the beginning of the QRS to the end of the T wave, which is 21 small boxes. Again, multiplying it with 0.04 is going to be 0.84. Now, getting the QTC interval using the Bassett's formula, we divide the assessed QT with the square root of the R to R interval in second. In this case, it is 1.8. So dividing 0.84 with the square root of that is 0.63. Going to the QRS axis determination using that of the hexagonal system, first, we need to examine the limb leads and look at the leads where the QRSs are most equiphasic. In this case, it is in lead AVF, where the amplitude of the R and the depth of the S is nearly equal. And looking at the axis, we know that AVF is positive 90, and the leads which are running perpendicular to it would be lead 1, towards lead 1, or the opposite, which is away from lead 1. So examining that lead, let's look at lead 1 here. We can see that lead 1 is predominantly negative. So it means that the axis is going away from it, and the axis in this patient is positive 180 degrees. Now, examining the precordial leads, we can see normal progression of the R wave from V1 to V3. However, we can see V4, V5, and also V6 exhibiting T-wave inversions. So looking at all the intervals, the duration, we interpret it with a sinus bradycardia because the rate is slow, lower than 60. Right axis deviation, we know that the axis is more than 90 degrees at 180. First degree AV block, because the PR interval is 0.28, more than the normal of 0.20. An IVCD because the QRS duration is 0.20, a prolonged QT interval assessed and corrected at 0.84 and 0.63 respectively, and the presence of anterolateral wall ischemia. But wait, we forgot something, which is looking at the standardization of this ECG. So looking at the amplitude calibration, it is calibrated at 10 millimeters per millivolt. So it's a standard calibration. Looking at the paper speed, however, we can see that this is 50 millimeters per second. In the previous video that I have introduced with the normal ECG, the usual standard is 25 millimeters per second, and that is where we base our 0.04 per second duration in that of small box, or that of 0.20 per one big box, or 1 second every 5 big boxes. However, with the 50 millimeter per second, it means that we need to multiply our rates by 2 and divide the durations and intervals by 2. So that will make our rate, in fact, as 66 beats per minute, both in the atria and the ventricles. The PR interval is now normal at 0.14. The QRS duration is 0.10. The QTA is 0.42, corrected at 0.44, still with the axis at 180 degrees. So with that realization, we now change our interpretation to a normal sinus rhythm, right axis division, and anterolateral wall ischemia. Then again, let us examine this ECG, specifically that of the axis. We notice that the complexes in lead 1 are all inverted, and in AVR, they are all upright, which is quite unusual because we know that lead 1 is usually positive and AVR is usually negative. Secondly, in the hexagonal axis, we in fact measured severe right axis deviation at 180 degrees. In fact, we know that inverted complexes in lead 1, upright complexes in lead AVR, and marked right axis deviation makes us suspect the presence of lead inversion, which in this case is a right and left arm lead inversion, meaning that the lead which was connected, or the electrodes on the right arm and the left, were actually interchanged. So in fact, we have requested for a repeat ECG, making sure that the electrodes are placed where they should be positioned, and making sure that the standard paper speed is at 25 millimeters per second, and the amplitude is at 10 millimeters per millivolt. And looking at the axis again, using the same system, AVF still demonstrates the equiphasic QRSS. So the lead perpendicular to that is going to be lead 1 again. Examining lead 1, which is now predominantly positive, it means that the axis is in fact going towards lead 1, which is 0 degree. So re-examining this ECG, we can also note the presence now of ST segment depression in leads 1, AVL, and T-wave inversions in V4, V5, and V6. And if you look closely at lead 2, you can see a widened and notched P-wave. So the correct reading, because of the standardization and making sure that the leads are correctly placed in their proper position, is actually normal sinus rhythm, normal axis, left atrial abnormality, and anterolateral wall ischemia. Thank you for reading this ECG with me. I hope you now appreciate the importance of proper ECG standardization and proper lead placement in patients. If you like similar contents, and if you want to learn more about ECG interpretations and arrhythmias, please consider subscribing to my channel and hit the notification bell so you'll get updated of new video uploads. I would also appreciate if you would write down your comments down below regarding topics that you would want me to discuss in the future. Again, thank you very much.